Thank you for the invitation to give a talk today at this Arctic Science Ministerial. In the following, I'll present an overview and some highlights from research conducted by me and my fellow research partners in our international collaborative and interdisciplinary work on young people and future sustainability in the Arctic. And here with the focus on a methodological framework that we are employing. This is work that has been coordinated and led by the Stefánsson Arctic Institute in Akureyri, Iceland, and with core funding from the Nordic Council of Ministers. Next, please. As for introduction, the research started out as a follow-up to the second Arctic Human Development Report and Arctic Social Indicator reports, but has since broadened beyond its initial scope to also include a basic methodological and conceptual framework that we are employing in this and other projects that involve young people's perspective in relation to big challenges such as sustainable development, climate change impacts, and adaptation. As many of you probably know, the Arctic Human Development Reports have become important baseline studies and assessments in terms of a number of broad themes. However, while also presenting a reference point for policymaking and priority setting, they have not provided specific attention to the issues and challenges facing young people. But clearly, it's important that we listen to the next generation and what their issues and challenges are. Next, please. In terms of background and rationale, therefore, with the Arctic Youth Project, we have sought to fill a critical gap in knowledge on the needs and aspirations of young people, their experiences and perspectives, and the challenges that confront them, with a primary focus on ages 18 to 28. The premise of the research is that the future of the Arctic and our ability to land on a sustainable trajectory would be determined to a great extent by today's youth, as they make choices around factors affecting their social and physical environment, where to study, where to live, what occupations and lifestyles to pursue, and so on. Indeed, bringing in the voices of youth is about critical capacity building for a sustainable future. Next, please. In terms of methods and data, we have conducted about 35 or more focus group interviews of varying size throughout the 8 Arctic states among people across the North. Each of these groups have averaged about 3 to 8 participants per group. So youth focus group participants have been of both urban and rural origin and indigenous and non-indigenous backgrounds. We have been in capital regions, but also in more rural settings. Some of the topics have included, as you see here, a fair and broad range, health and well-being, education and employment, migration, mobility, and economic futures, language, tradition, social life, climate and environmental change, and just a lot of issues facing young people. So the co-production and discussion with these youth have consisted of a variety of settings as well, with close engagement and dialogues as a way of getting as many perspectives as possible, including different types of knowledge, and while being observant, of course, about the importance of inclusiveness as regards the composition of these groups. Next, please. The main questions that we have posed in these focus groups have been on a kind. First, what do you think are the most important issues facing young people living in the Arctic region? And we pose that question as a way of sort of opening up to hear anything that were pressing issues for the youth. And then secondly, we pose follow-up questions that were more specifically related to the Arctic social indicator frameworks and the quality of life domains. And then thirdly, in conclusion, we ask whether there was anything we had missed. Is there anything else we should be thinking about as we try to understand issues facing young people? Next, please. In terms of results, we obtained an extensive set of data from completed focus group discussions, which has then enabled our project to capture a variety of perspectives, challenges, opportunities, living conditions, and circumstances among young people today. These overall results are being analyzed and presented in the context of quality of life domains of human development. Just to give you sort of a brief snapshot of the type of comments we received in the focus groups, here's a list of examples from the Nordic countries and Greenland. So what we heard were you know, that youth would express a sense of fate control, feeling that they were the generation that could change things, that they had all the opportunities, but at the same time, you know, that create a certain feeling of anxiety, this feeling of having to be perfect. They also expressed a growing sense of Northern identity and pride. They talked about it being cool to be a proud Northerner. There was a lot of talk about education as a key thing. Youth talked about the importance of education also as a way of getting away from their community. They talked about the importance also of investing in human resources in general, also in the trades, not just university education was something we often heard. And in Greenland, a critical challenge being raised over and over again is the language barrier in education. Youth also talked about the need for entrepreneurs and the need to show young people how to do things, how to start a business. And they expressed a need for role models, good role models. They said there are so many opportunities. It's expensive to own a business and we need people who can show us how to do things. They also talked about climate change. They said that climate is something that worries us, but we feel we are too small to change things and often politicians don't listen. There was also a lot of talk about contact with nature. They talked about how traditions have changed. And nature today is more a place for physical and mental health. For example, young people in Iceland talked about the need for being close to nature, the importance of nature and outdoor activity as a calming effect. Nature is important for physical and mental health is something that we heard over and over again. So this is just a very small snapshot of things. Next, please. In terms of the results from question 2 and 3, where we sort of broadened out and highlighted the Arctic social indicators, domains and quality of life domains, there were a variety of responses. We presented first the ASI framework, which further stimulated our conversations and provided for critical feedback from the youth participants, Arctic social and biophysical indicators, of course, as you know, are important in risk management and as an adaptation tool, and getting the perspective of use is highly valuable. Additional domains for devising indicators were brought forward by the youth in our conversations, and in particular, suggestions relating to issues of connectivity, accessibility, and sense of safety were being raised. Receiving the perspectives and feedback from young people on this framework, the domain areas and associated indicators has been highly valuable for further development of this critical monitoring system for tracking impacts of global change. This contributes overall to our ability to monitor human development with more robust indicators, which is of critical importance given the changes happening in the North today. Overall, discussions have contributed to the relevance of quality of life domains for devising indicators or for confirming these indicators. And they have also provided critical data that has enabled us to rethink what the most effective and appropriate indicator should be and has contributed to our efforts to rearticulate the thematic categories and augment the quality of life domains and associated indicators that have served as a basis for assessing monitoring human development in the Arctic and well-being. Next step, please. So in terms of next steps, first, we of course working on completing a report and scientific journal articles that are focusing on these very valuable results about how the youth see the future. And secondly, critical considerations are flowing from this as we move forward in ongoing research on the sustainability of our economy, society, and environment. There's a need for adjustment of indicators within existing domains. And there's a need for addition of new and biophysical domains to achieve a more holistic approach to monitoring the future of the North. And then we are also looking at how we might widen the scope to include a broader segment of the youth cohort. The framework and methods we have completed in our studies of Arctic youth provide critical input to our current ongoing research in two large EU Horizon 2020 projects. First, the youth project provides input to Nunatariuk, which is a permafrost thaw and Arctic coast project that we participate in. And by way of participatory research, the young people, we are addressing the impacts of an adaptation to climate change and mitigation strategies and risks associated with permafrost thaw. Also, similarly, there's the Arctic Youth Project's contribution into the Just North toward just, ethical, sustainable Arctic economies, environments, and societies project, which is another Horizon project that we are partnering in, that is designed to explore the multitude of ethical systems that coexist in the Arctic and to assess the viability of new economic activities in the region. So the youth perspective are critical components in these projects. And lastly, I just want to mention that Arctic youth has become one among several major themes being considered now in early discussions of a third Arctic Human Development Report. And with this, I would just like to thank you for listening.